I guess maybe when you get to be my age, you think about time a little bit more than some of you young folks here in the audience. But for whatever reason, I've kind of had it on my mind this week. And as you know, that always bodes unfortunate for you because I usually share with you when when these things come up. So I wanted to talk a little bit about time, and we've talked about it a few times in the past. But I do have a little bit of a conclusion to it. So I just, for those of you who are not particularly enamored with scientific discussions, I'll just beg your patience and tolerance this morning as we wade through this quickly, and then we'll get back to our text. I'll start with the third chapter of Ecclesiastes. You remember that? Only instead of me reading it or telling you about it, I'll let the birds explain it to you.
To everything.
we don't even stop and think about it because it's just the way things are, but we are slaves to time. Every minute of our day is controlled by time. And yet we have such a little understanding and grasp of what time even is. We got our calendars and we know I've got to be here at this time, therefore I've got to start to leave for there at this time, which means I've got to get started getting ready at this time, which means I've got to get up at this time because I need this much time for whatever, breakfast or whatever. There's no part of our life that is not just completely consumed with the idea of time. And yet, scientifically, time is a really elusive thing. And when we think outside of time, then we really are in deep water, aren't we? How do you visualize eternity, which we generally consider to be outside of time? And what does that mean, if it's in time or outside of time? What is time? Well, if you look at in the dictionary, you'll find that time is a fundamental concept that measures the sequence of events, the duration between them, and their order. They asked Einstein to define time, and he said it's what a clock says. It's a dimension in which events occur in linear fashion, proceeding from the past to the present and into the future. So when does time exist? Now, the past is not time. That's history. The future is not time. It hadn't happened yet. Time is now. Plays a crucial role in physics, philosophy, and everyday life, influencing how we perceive and organize our experiences. We arrange our whole lives around this idea of time. It's considered to be a fundamental aspect of the space-time fabric. In practice, we use the orbit and the rotation of the Earth as a metric for how we see time. We see it in terms of years. How long does it take our Earth to make an orbit around the sun? In terms of months, days, hours, seconds. Why do we have a calendar set up in 365 days? It's all related back to physical rotation and physical orbiting. In theory, if there were no rotation or orbiting in the universe, time would still exist. I'm not sure how we would measure it. It would be different, because all of our time is based on that sort of phenomenon. But if you have a sequence of events in a linear movement, then you would still have time. Time would still exist, but it would be different, wouldn't it? Because we think of everything in terms, basically, of these core movements based on natural phenomena. Largest practical measurement of time is the age of the universe. Smallest theoretical measurement of time is the Planck time. Planck time is a time it takes for light to travel a Planck length in a vacuum. It's an extremely short duration. Mathematically, it's notated as 5.39 times 10 to the minus 44 seconds. That's not very long. So how long is the longest measure of time? Well, when did time begin? From then till now is the longest measure of time. Was that 8 or 10,000 years ago when God created Adam and put him in the Garden of Eden? Or was it 13 billion years ago when a Big Bang occurred? Whatever your understanding of that is, that's kind of the longest measure of time. The shortest measure of time gets more complicated. The shortest interval of time that has been measured, we just talked about the theoretical shortest time, this is the shortest that scientists have actually measured, is 247 zeptoseconds. How many of you have zeptoseconds on your watch? One zeptosecond is the time it takes a particle or a wave of light. Which, is light a wave or is it a particle? Well, yes. It's a particle when it's not a wave, and it's a wave when it's not a particle, or else it's a wave and a particle at the same time. When you figure that out, you may be subject to the Nobel Prize. So good luck with that. The zeptosecond is represented as a trillionth of a billionth of a second. That's kind of short. It's actually been measured. There are approximately 5.39 times 10 to the 22nd power zeptoseconds in a Planck time. But that's theoretic. They haven't measured that. They've only measured the zeptosecond. Did you know time was that complicated? Did you know it was that complex? Did you know it was that precise? We talk about light years in reference to the relationship with time and light. One light year is 5.88 trillion miles. A car traveling at 60 miles per hour could go one light year in approximately 9.8 times 10 to the 10th power. If you decide to make that trip, you probably need to pack an extra tube of toothpaste. It's going to take you a little while. Light travels at a speed of 186,000 miles per second, 11,160,000 miles per minute, 671 million miles per hour. Closest neighbor star is Alpha Centauri. It's 4.24 light years away from our sun. I don't know if your boss will let you have that much time off to go over there or not. There are two ways that time is measured, and we're about to get to the end of this, so just be patient. Time is measured either as dynamic, which relies on the motion of the celestial bodies. This includes Earth to keep track of time, whether it's in the rotation time of a distant spinning star, such as a pulsar, or the motion of a star across our night sky, or the rotation of the Earth. We talked about that a minute ago, that this is how we think of time normally, in terms of the movement of celestial beings, of celestial entities. If you have some of our watches and some of your clocks at home are regulated by atomic time, right? Atomic time relies on the energy transition. And energy transition means a change or a jump of an electron from one energy level to another within the atom of the cesium atom. So inside this tiny little atom, as energy goes from one level to the other level, inside the nucleus of that electron, of that atom, cesium, that period of time is called an energy transition. And that's how atomic clocks are regulated. Using this atomic method, the definition of a second is now defined as 9,192,631,770 transitions within a cesium atom. A second using the atomic method can be measured with an accuracy of losing a tiny portion of a second in a million years. That's how accurate your atomic watch is. So what? So what? Why do we care? Well, this was a takeaway that I went through all of this to share with you, and I think you probably already figured it out. The amount of faith that it takes to believe this complexity, control, and design that we call time accidentally happened is orders of magnitude larger than to believe a designing, creating, controlling power we call God exists. Amen? Amen. All of that to get to that. I could have started with that and saved all of us some time, but I didn't. And that brings us to our text. And we finished last week talking about the beheading of John the Baptist, and we won't revisit that. But when John's disciples heard about this, they came and took his body and placed it in a tomb. Kind of a weird thing. Here's a little bit of aftermath of that event that we can draw upon. It says that we can say that it is inferred by this verse that John's body was discarded, that it was uncared for, that it was unburied, and that the disciples were able to find out where it was and went without any objection from anybody and recovered the body and treated it with dignity and respect and gave it a proper burial. Josephus, the leading historian of that time, said that after the beheading, the mutilated remains were cast out of the prison and left neglected. God's judgment is at length found out. Herod, not long after this, he was defeated by Aretas in a great battle, and he was put to ignominious flight. It didn't go well for Herod after he desecrated and beheaded John the Baptist. Herodias, Herod's illegal wife, herself and Herod were banished by a decree of the Roman Senate of Lions, where they both perished miserably. Nicephorus, Greek emperor in 802 AD, relates that Salome, this was the daughter of Herodias, fell through some treacherous ice in such a manner that her head was caught, while the rest of her body sank into the water. In her efforts to save herself, her head was nearly severed by the sharp edges of the broken ice. I don't know if that's true or not, but that was the understood history of the day in the first century that had happened, which is kind of ironic that she would come so close to being beheaded after she had been instrumental in causing the beheading of John the Baptist. When the apostles returned, and that is when they came back from their limited commission that we've been talking about for the last few weeks, they reported to Jesus what they had done. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they're going to get into a boat and they're going to go to a different location to get away and have a little time of rest and requiet and refresh themselves. So they went away by themselves in a boat to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias, to a solitary deserted place. Luke says they went to a place that was near Bethsaida. I understand that there were two different places called Bethsaida. Bethsaida just means a fishing village. And we know the one where the apostles kind of grew up, some of the apostles. This one, I believe, is a little different one, so it's a little bit further away from there than that. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. So they were very anxious not to be separated from Jesus and his miraculous powers. So this is where we get into the event of Jesus feeding the multitude. And we'll start this with the Chosen video that shows this event, and then we'll come back and look at the text and unpack it a little bit more. I don't think I saw anybody wash their hands before they started eating. So our text here is going to be a little bit convoluted because it's recorded in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, and we're in the Ethelgard Smith, whose book we're using, kind of tries to weave it all together. So it may be a little bit disjointed as we go through it. So just be patient with that, if you would. So when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. And of course, in the video, you saw that he was teaching familiar things that we have in our text. So he began teaching them many things, and he welcomed them and spoke to them about the kingdom of God and healed those who were needing healing. The Jewish Passover festival was near. He had said earlier that no animal is more, he had said that he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. If you've been around sheep very much, you know that they're notorious for being not terribly bright. The commentator said that no animal is more helpless, more stupid, more in need of a shepherd than the sheep. Saint Chrysostom, I can't pronounce that, observes that the scribes were not so much pastors as they were wolves, because by teaching errors both by word and by example, they perverted the minds of the simple. So here you have a group of people who should have had an abundance of shepherds, the rabbis and the scribes and the teachers of the law, and yet Jesus is saying that they were like sheep without a shepherd because they were not guiding them in the way that they should be going. By this time, it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it's already very late. Send the people away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." A little bit naive, I think, on the part of the disciples. I can understand why they would say that. Not many options available. But, you know, you've got a huge crowd here. How many people? How many were there? I see some 5,000. 5,000 what? Men. How many women and children? I don't know. Bunches. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for all these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. And Philip answered, It would take more than half a year's wages, or more than 200 denarii, as some translations say, to buy enough bread for each one to have even a bite. Another of the disciples, Andrew, Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will they go among so many?" Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties, taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of the men who had eaten was 5,000. Why 12? Why did they pick up 12 baskets full? Why would that be even stated or remembered? What was important about that? I guess maybe each of the disciples needed some leftovers to take home. There were 12 apostles, so 12 baskets, right? Maybe. Maybe there's more to it than that.
Well, in the Jewish mind, the number 12, as you mentioned, you have 12 apostles, but 12 relates all the way back to the number of tribes of Israel, but even more importantly, 12 is symbolic of the true faith or the true religion. This is, in addition to the symbolism of manna from heaven and God providing the manna and the fish maybe taking the place of the quail, this is a symbol that God has provided this, and this is from heaven. It's not something that I don't know exactly how to say it. It's not something that you can deny that this was a heavenly gift.
Yeah, and we've talked about it over and over and over again, the importance of numerology among the Hebrew people. Every number has a meaning, has a history, has an explanation, has a spiritual application. And certainly 12 is very much, as David said, very much in that category. After the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who was to come into the world." Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to Bethsaida. This is the Bethsaida near Capernaum. In fact, some of the gospel writers say Capernaum instead of Bethsaida, but they're right there in that area. This is where Jesus had been much of his adult life as he was beginning his public ministry. And he stayed behind to dismiss the crowd. Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. By now it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them, and a strong wind was blowing, and the waters grew rough. So next week, Lord willing, we'll come to the event of Jesus goes up to this solitary place, lingers there. The apostles have headed back toward home in the boat, and the Sea of Galilee has become very rough. And they've been rowing hard and not making very much progress. And it's dark, it's night, it's the middle of the night, the fourth watch of the night. And this ghost is suddenly going to appear. So we'll pick that up then, Lord willing, next week. We've got just a minute or two if anyone has any final thoughts about the feeding of the 5,000. Truly one of the remarkable miracles that Jesus performed.
Well, when you first think about the two fish and the five loaves, being a cook, you know, when you got that many people to feed, it seems a daunting task. But I know from experience, if you take a can of tuna fish, you turn that tuna fish into a lot of food with five loaves. Because when you put them together, that becomes a whole meal for 5,000 people when you think about it. But the significance of it is that they were able to do it and then at the same time bless each individual that was there. So I think that's what Jesus was trying to get the disciples to understand, that they could take a little something and make it be a very big something.
Absolutely. Yes, indeed. All right, well, our time is up. Thank you so much for your patience with me and your attention, and have a wonderful God bless week.